there's an awful lot in those block notes that I don't have time to say right now. She's put a lot in about dates between now and mid-December, so there's a lot of information there. Remember, Sunday school options are available for children during the service. Please contact our Director of Religious Education, Ms. Trippy, for more information, just to make sure that we have somebody there when you need them, because if nobody's going to be there, we don't have somebody there. In addition to posting meeting minutes on the vestry bulletin board for the joint shared priest committees of St. Bartholomew and the Church of the Good Shepherd, copies of the meeting minutes are on the table in the library. They have blue sheets on them. In addition, copies of all the meeting minutes up to date have been put in the mail slots for those people that are on the vestry. Also, I encourage you, there's only so much information that you can put in the meeting minutes. So if you've got questions and want more information, please contact me. You can talk to me after the service. Or give me a call. My phone number is in the book. I will discuss it. Sometimes there's some information that is a little proprietary, but most of it I can talk about. At least give you an update as to where we are. We're actually making very good progress on that. And along those, a note I think I've sent out to people on the committee, but I'm not sure if everybody's seen your email. There was going to be a meeting this Thursday, but one of the people that's part of the committee from Church of the Good Shepherd had a death in the family, so they wouldn't be able to attend their key person, so it's being postponed by a week until October 6th at 7 p.m. Okay, a big item is wine is going to be reintroduced at home in communion service starting the first Sunday of Advent, which is November 27th. As usual, it will be up to the individual communicants to decide if they want to take wine. We did some research about this. It's up to the individual parishes to make decisions and the individual communicants. We looked at it from a bunch of different directions. We'll be doing a variation of what we do today on Sunday with the host here and the wine off to the side. Because of that, we need to get together with all of the people who are lay Eucharistic ministers that are going to help to kind of go through things, because it'll be different. And that's scheduled to be Sunday, October 23rd, and if somebody can't make it to that date, just let Father Bob know and they can bring him up to speed. We are only doing sipping from the cup, not tincture, because part of what we found as we researched it is your fingers are a much worse source of contamination than your saliva. So that's a safer thing to do. And there are actually been quite long-term studies on this. So we're pretty confident that it's safe, but again, it's up to you. Saturday, November 5th, Russ Trippy will hold another Saturday session called Transcendent. For more information, please see Russ on the website. Please consider donating canned or packaged dry food to food pantry baskets in the entrance to the church building. A reminder, we do have a 6-foot particle and steel, particle-proof steel tables for sale. And let's see. The other item is, again, please see the flock notes and the announcements at the end of today's bulletin for other important information. And let Dorothea know if you have announcements that you want to be part of. to tell out my soul. Thank you.
God, you the fullness of your grace, that we, running to obtain your promises, may become partakers of your heavenly treasure. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever.
Chapter 6, verses 1a and 4 through 7. Alas for those who are at ease in Zion, and those who feel secure on Mount Samaria, the notables of the first nations, to whom the house of Israel resorts. Alas for those who lie on beds of ivory, and lounge on their couches, and eat lamb from the flock, and calves from the stall. Who sing idle songs to the sound of the harp, and like David, improvise on instruments of music. Who drink wine from bowls, and anoint themselves with the finest oils, but are not grieved over the ruin of Joseph. Therefore they shall now be the first to go into exile, and the revelry of the loungers shall pass away. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The portion of the appointed Psalter for this day is Psalm 146, verses 1 through 9. We'll read responsively by whole verse. Hallelujah! Praise the Lord, O my soul. I will praise the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praises to my God while I have my being.
Put not your trust in rulers, nor in any child of earth, for there is no help in them.
When they breathe their last, they return to earth, and in that day their thoughts perish.
Happy are they.
Who made heaven and earth, the seas, and all that is in them, who keeps his promise forever.
Who gives justice to those who are oppressed, and food to those who hunger.
The Lord sets the prisoners free. The Lord opens the eyes of the blind. The Lord lifts up those who are bowed down.
The Lord loves the righteous.
Combined with content. For we brought nothing into the world so that we can take nothing out of it. But if we have food and clothing, we will be content with these. But those who want to be rich fall into temptation and are trapped by many senseless and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. And in their eagerness to be rich, some have wandered away from the faith and pierced themselves with many pains. But as for you, man of God, shun all this, pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, endurance, gentleness. Fight the good fight of the faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called for and for which you made good confession in the presence of many witnesses, in the presence of God, who gives life to all things, and of Christ Jesus, when his testimony before Pontius Pilate made the good confession. I charge you to keep the commandment without spot or blame until the manifestation of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he will bring about at the right time. He who is blessed and only sovereign, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. It is he alone who has immortality and dwells in unapproachable light, whom no one has ever seen or can see. To him be all honor and eternal dominion. Amen. As for those who are present, who in the present age are rich, command them not to be haughty or set their hopes on the uncertainty of riches, but rather on God, who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. They are to do good, to be rich in good works, generous, ready to share, thus storing up for themselves the treasure of a good foundation for the future, so that they may take hold of the life that really is life. The word of the Lord.
Besides all this, between you and us, a great chasm has been fixed, so that those who might want to pass from here to you cannot do so, and no one can cross from there to us. He said, "Then, Father, I beg you, send him to my father's house, for I have five brothers, that he may warn them, so that they will not also come into this place of torment." Abraham replied, "They have Moses and the prophets. They should listen to them." He said, "No, Father Abraham, but if someone goes to them from the dead, they will repent." He said to him, "If they do not listen to Moses and the prophets, neither will they be convinced, even if someone rises from the dead." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
My soul yearns.
Since then, the good news of the kingdom of God is preached, and everyone enters it violently. But it is easier for heaven and earth to pass away than for one dot of the law to become void. Everyone who divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery, and he who marries a woman divorced from her husband commits adultery. There was a rich man who was clothed in purple. Now, our 21st century ears hear that discourse, and to us it sounds rather like the ranting of a lunatic, doesn't it? First, Jesus talks about the kingdom of God, and then without any logical transition, he asserts that remarriage of divorced persons is adultery. And then he tells an irrelevant story about a rich man with a poor man at his gate. The apparent lunatic sounds as if it were an erratic set of Dominical sayings is embarrassing. It's so embarrassing that the Standing Liturgical Commission of the Episcopal Church has purged the text from our lectionary so as not to trouble us with it. They purged the difficult Dominical saying and left us only with a pleasant story. But let's take the time to attempt to understand what Holy Scripture is trying to say to us. Some people think that Luke has used Christ's saying about the law at this point in his gospel to slip in a stern word about divorce and remarriage. But that misses the point of the text altogether. You see, what Jesus is explaining to the Pharisees, chortling off to one side, is that until John the Baptizer came preaching the kingdom of God to the Jewish people, until John the Baptizer, the law of Moses and the sayings of the prophets were meant to give an earthly community of faith advice to govern that earthly community of faith. And in an earthly community of faith, the Pharisees, among others, had authority to interpret the law of Moses and the prophets in such a way as to make allowances for human frailty, so as to, for a fee, mend bad decisions thereby promote social harmony. But since John, and with the advent of Jesus, the kingdom of God, a heavenly community, is being preached. And a heavenly community of faith is different from an earthly one, Jesus tells the Pharisees. A heavenly community of faith, Jesus says, cannot endure the erasure, cannot endure the changing of a single dot of the sacred and eternal law of God. In the kingdom of heaven, for instance, you are united to your God in a spiritual union, Jesus says. You are united to your God in a spiritual union that is very much like a marriage, Christ says. In Christ, your eternal self is married to the eternal God absolutely, in heart and mind and will and substance. Christ Jesus, the incarnate Word, has adorned you with grace as a bride is made ready for her bridegroom. And by your entry into the divine kingdom by water and the Holy Spirit, by entry into the kingdom of God by your baptism, you are joined to God so that he is your husband and you are his beloved. And anyone, Jesus tells the Pharisees, who have interrupted him with their laughing, anyone who is joined to God and divorces himself from God in order to marry themselves to mammon commits adultery. And anyone who admires and desires the lifestyle of someone who has divorced herself from God also commits adultery. It is as if, Jesus says, it is as if a rich man got up one morning, perfumed himself, and put on fine, clean linen, over which he adorned himself with a purple robe, and went to take a sumptuous breakfast of wine and sweetbreads and fruit. While he was so occupied, one of his servants comes in to ask what he should do about a notoriously ulcerous and destitute individual named Lazarus, who has been dumped by some drunkards outside the rich man's gate and is unable to leave because he can neither either walk nor crawl. And the rich man thinks, well, I guess the rules of charity given by God to Moses require me to bring him in off the street, give him a little something to eat, and to use one of my nice linen sheets to have him carried to a brothel where the whores can take care and look after him. But no! If I do that, the louts who brought him here in the first place will most likely notice and bring another destitute person to annoy me. And I will expend all my wealth, not to mention my sheets, on human rubbish. And so the rich man says to his servant, do nothing. Perhaps the drunkards who brought him here will return and tote him off someplace else. Now, Jesus doesn't make much of it, but he is very specific about where Lazarus has been thrown, the text says. Lazarus lay at the gate of the rich man, clothed in purple. And what Jesus intends for us to imagine is a fairly typical residential compound, consisting of a residence with perhaps other buildings, surrounded by a high wall in which is set a gate leading in from the street into an open courtyard which is apart from the street noises and dangers. And Jesus says that Lazarus had been thrown not along one of the walls surrounding the rich man's house, but he had been thrown so that he lay at the rich man's gate. And a place where Lazarus might have been brought to the gate's other side, so that a servant might toss him a crust of bread or a heel of cheese. And he wouldn't have been bothered by those cussed dogs. Lazarus might have had the peace and safety of the rich man's enclosure, but the gate keeps him out. It is as if it were a great chasm that Lazarus cannot cross. Lazarus lay outside the rich man's gate. And that is why when the rich man dies some years later and discovers that he has outlived his mammon and is in an arid place where nothing of his life has survived to abide with him, and he knows only the torment of desiring to have something. Because Lazarus lay outside the rich man's gate, Abraham cannot send Lazarus, who has also died. Abraham cannot send Lazarus to bring anything to the man who had been rich, not even a drop of water. Because Lazarus lay outside the rich man's gate and the rich man chose not to open it for mercy's sake, a great chasm has been fixed, Abraham says. A great chasm has been fixed because that's the way you wanted it. Your adulterous love of mammon has divorced you from the mercies of heaven, Abraham says. And you have placed yourself beyond heaven's reach. Jesus is telling us in this parable that we who are the church, we who are espoused to the God of mercy and grace by water and the holy baptism, we must nourish our fidelity to him who is the church's husband by expending what is earthly in order to participate in the mercy and grace which is divine. We must, each one of us, use the things that entice us to have them for their own sake and so divorce ourselves from God. We must use our money and time and liberality so that each of us might be an open gate into the peace and safety of the enclosures of heaven, so that there is never any chasm to separate us from the bosom of God. Amen.
Amen.
Let us confess our faith in God, saying together the Nicene Creed. We Cheer the anxious, comfort the bereaved, succor the dying, have mercy on the fallen. Turn the heart of Mr. Putin, O Lord, that he may repent of his villainy and withdraw his military from Ukraine. And hasten the time, O Lord, when war shall cease in all the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O Lord, our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people. In the multitude of your mercies, look with compassion upon us and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O Lord of souls, and to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will. Walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on us. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness. And by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
Virgin Mary. Be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In Him, you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In Him, you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before He died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when He had given thanks to you, He broke it and gave it to His disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, He took the cup of wine. And when He had given thanks, He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to His command, O Father,
we remember His death, we proclaim His resurrection, we await His coming in glory.
And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this water. We pray, you gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and His blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in His sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through Him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country, where with the ever-blessed Virgin Mary, blessed Bartholomew, done